This is right.
Well, when you think of Carl Hubbell, you'll think along the same lines with Fernando Valenzuela. Five strikeouts in a row, and Fernando, congratulations. Different names in that order, the last one being Teddy Higuera, but it's still there.
Yeah, I'm very happy for the record, you know, because I know everybody knows who is Carl Hubbell, great star, and I'm very happy for Tiger's record.
And, of course, you've got the bat right here. You couldn't convince Whitey Herzog that you wanted to hit.
No. You know, but I think we have a lot of real hitters, you know, and it's because pinching for me, I threw three innings. I think it's okay.
Fernando, congratulations.
Okay, thanks.
All right, let's go back to Al Michaels.
All right, Don. You got to love Fernando as you look at Mike Scott. Bat in hand. The other night, he's a pinch hitter. Went from first to third on a nice base-running play, but then tired himself out to the point where Oral Hershiser had to go in to run for him. Mike Scott, who leads the majors in strikeouts, starts the seventh inning with a fastball to Cal Ripken that's hit foul toward the bullpen, and Hernandez runs out of room. Now, other changes for the National League. Here, Raines stays in the game in left field, and Chili Davis is in center with Steve Sachs at second. And we'll give you the American League changes as well, or a look right now at the lineup. In case you're keeping score, it should look like that. And they'll replace Higuera because he's gone three, and Mosby has already replaced Henderson in left field. 1-1 the count on Ripken. Mike Scott, who's thrown that split-fingered fastball, and some will say something else as well on his route to success this season. What might that be, James? And we'll have to open up Mr. Palmer's mic. I think Scott probably cut you off.
Well, that was a split-fingered fastball, which is, and there you see the, what he calls it is a cut fastball. And what makes that pitch effective is the one he threw before. A little more pressure on the middle finger. Watch the ball sail away. Ripken doesn't see that pitch too often. Of course, when you're throwing the ball around 96 miles per hour, it's going to make it even more effective. But going back to what you said earlier about the San Francisco Giants, Roger Craig has been the advocate of that split-fingered fastball, and it's made all the difference in the world for Mike Scott. I wonder what his record would be if the Astros here in Houston had scored a lot of runs and supported him well.
He's pitched brilliantly nearly every time out.
Last year, 18-8. This year, similar record.
1-0 on Barfield, batting for the second time in the game, and there's the pitch, and it's 1-1.
That was that split-finger fastball, and I'm wondering what Roger Craig is thinking now when he taught it to Mike Scott. He was a scout for the Detroit Tigers. Now he's a manager with the San Francisco Giants, and they're a game ahead of the Astros. And he's looking at his at the Astros and their main competitor's best pitcher. Interesting.
And I think Roger's one of those that thinks Scott is throwing that other pitch as well.
Yes, complained about it.
Uh-huh. Well, Buck Rogers up in Montreal. But of course, he said the other day, though, he thinks he's gotten honest.
Don't ask Barfield.
And why he has struck out over more than one batter per inning, 167 and 161. The ball just, the bottom falls out. If you do hit the ball, you hit the top half of the ball and it's a grounder. Very effective pitch.
Jim, he is, Mike Scott has told me that that pitch is not that difficult to throw. If that's the case, and a lot of pitchers see the success that most pitchers are having with that pitch, why aren't more of them throwing it?
Well, first of all, I think you have to have an overhand delivery, and Mike Scott has that. Secondly, you have to have long fingers, which he has. Number three, you have to have the right guy teach you, and Roger Craig did it in 10 days.
Frank White of the Kansas City Royals takes a strike. And the crowd coming to life as they sense Scott striking the side out. He's got Ripken, he's got Barfield, and White is hitting for Whitaker. 0-2. In a way, it's reminiscent of the game a couple of years ago in San Francisco with all the strikeouts.
Well, I think the major difference, that was a twilight game. You expect that. You can see a little bit better here in the dome.
White makes contact, and good deep contact to center field and gone on an 0-2 pitch with the crowd roaring for the sign to be struck out. Frank White hits one out, and the American League leads 3-0. Frank White, who you'll recall was the cleanup hitter in the World Series for Kansas City last year.
We've seen two home runs tonight for the American League. They're both on 0-2 pitches. They're both what you would call mistakes. That was supposed to be one of those cut fastballs that didn't cut. A little bit too much of the plate. Frank White, as you said, has become a home run hitter. 22 last year, 10 already this year. Drills at the left center.
3-0, and Harold Baines now batting for Higuera. We'll see Huff in the bottom of the seventh inning as Baines of the White Sox, the sole representative of the White Sox, stands in to face Scott. Baines batting 316. A quiet type, but a solid and very steady player. And he grounds it to the right side, where Sachs gets his first chance of the game and throws to Hernandez to retire the side. But White hits a homer, and the American League leads 3-0.
The 1986 All-Star Game is brought to you by Coors and Coors Light. Beers with a difference worth tasting.
Millions are cheering. The triumph. The laughter.
Can you break a log like that?
Don't know. Never been attacked by a tree.
The exhilaration.
Oh, that was a little close.
Of Karate Kid Part 2. This summer, don't miss that special magic.
In Okinawa, I'm very serious.
Karate Kid Part 2, rated PG. Now at select theaters. Check newspapers for showtimes.
Who's gonna be at the Silver Bullet
is
tonight?
Is it from the girl with the gray jacket?
You told him it was from me.
Thought I was doing you a favor.
I want to be invisible.
Kelly, you're a friend of mine. He's a friend of mine.
I can't believe it.
Look, I'll buy you guys a couple of Coors Lights. We'll forget it ever happened, okay?
But Rob, just tell me something. What did he say?
He said thanks.
There's no slowing down with the Silver Bullet tonight.
Coors Light beer.
I don't need drugs. I believe in me and my ability. I don't want anything interfering with the way I play the game. Cocaine's no way to believe in yourself. Hey, it can kill you. If you're into cocaine, get off it. You're living a lie. Get off it while you still have a life.
Cocaine, the big lie. Call 1-800-662-HELP. Furnished by Major League Baseball in cooperation with the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services.
Saturday.
They
say. They say that you led them on.
No.
You wanted to go to bed with them.
No.
When she says no.
Before we go to the bottom of the seventh, here's all the scoring in the game. Second inning, Winfield at second base. Two out, 0-2 on Lou Whitaker. Over the wall. 2-0 American League, and it stays that way until the seventh inning with two out, and again an 0-2 count. Mike Scott working, and Frank White hits one out. And so it's 3-0 American League. The American League has not won an All-Star game in a National League ballpark in 24 years. The last time was 1962 at Wrigley Field in Chicago. That was one of the years in which they played two All-Star games. First one was in Washington, and the second one at Clark and Addison. Charlie Huff, who throws the knuckleball for the Texas Rangers. Hernandez, it's a soft fly ball to right field, and Barfield gathers it. One away. Hernandez taken care of, and Gary Carter coming up.
Quite a story. Charlie Huff broke his pinky finger on his pitching hand, shaking hands. kind of messing around with a guy early in the season, or really in spring training. Won 9 games. You kind of wonder if he had been there all year, where the Rangers would be, only a game and a half out in the American League West. The biggest question I had, Al, was to Lance Parrish, who is catching the knuckleball. Have you ever done it before? He said, yeah, I did it at AAA level. And I said, how do you go about doing it? Do you wait for the ball to get to you, or do you try to go out and snag it? He said, of course, Tim, you know about this. He said, you can't wait for the ball to get to you, because it sometimes doesn't.
Well, as you see Carter up there, I'll tell you the best explanation that I have ever heard about how to hit the knuckleball, and it was told to me by Duke Snyder, who used to play catch on the sidelines with Gil Hodges, who had an excellent knuckleball. And Duke, who hit the knuckleball very well, learned how to hit it because he waited to catch it. And that's what you have to do to hit it. You have to wait until the last minute, and that's the same formula you have to take into it when you take into consideration when you try to catch the ball. You wait till the last minute and you snare it.
There's a look at the National League lineup the way it is at the moment and where they're hitting, with Scott now in the number 2 spot. 2-1 to Carter is in the air to right field, and Barfield has another play, and that's 2-9 in the scorebook here in the seventh inning. I still think the best explanation was Bob Uecker, how to catch the knuckleball. Pick it up when it stops rolling.
Exactly. Wait till it stops rolling and pick it up.
There's an example of waiting a little bit long with Gary Carter. He waited, got the ball in on him, and fly ball to right field.
Well, by waiting when you're trying to catch it, and I caught 3 knuckleballers, among whom were Bob Tiefenauer and Barney Schultz back in 1964, who came to the Cardinals. But by waiting on it, your arms relax, and that's how you catch it most effectively, with relaxed arms.
Parker hits it foul, and the count is 0-1. Dave Parker batting for the first time in the game. Parker of the resurgent Reds in what's a true 16 battle in the National League West. You go figure it out. Anybody can win that division. And the Reds playing very well just prior to the All-Star break. Mattingly snares it, makes the play unassisted. And that's the 6th time in 7 innings the Nationals have gone out 1-2-3 as you look at Ralph Kiner and Kathleen Sullivan.
Hello. Ed's book on advertising says the consumer will remember your TV commercial better if it has a memorable visual device. Well, the message we would like you to remember is to be sure to enjoy Bartles and James on Ice this summer. You cannot find a lighter, more refreshing summertime beverage. As for the visual device, Ed says you will probably be able to figure that out all by yourself. So once again, please remember Bartles and James on Ice. And thank you for your continued support.
You know, I love everything about this car.
New Chevy Nova. It's a lot more than you'd expect for the price.
And I really like the way it's built.
95% of Chevy Nova owners would recommend their new Nova to a friend.
There's so much room.
Oh, I thought you'd like it.
And it doesn't cost much to keep it filled either.
New Nova.
It's a lot more than you'd expect for the price.
And now get 5.9 annual percentage rate GMAC financing. Length of finance contract is limited. New Nova from today's Chevrolet.
On the road, nobody can get you a great hot meal faster than McDonald's. And I figured out how they do it. Ginny calls signals, sends Carl deep for a Big Mac, and cuts inside for your Coke. Look at him fly. Back here, you got Joel putting the moves on a Big Mac. Doink, doink. Now Carl hands off to Beth and clears the lane. This team's got it together. See what I mean? It all ends with a pass to you. Hot and fast.
You get it hot, you get it fast.
Want to see it again? Drive on in.
At McDonald's.
Life is full of changes, and State Farm is there.
I'm State Farm Agent George Palmy. If your family's like mine, you'll find reminders of how fast things change. Wasn't so long ago my daughter Jill was riding in this. Now she drives this. Look around you. If you see your insurance needs have changed, auto, home, life, or health, see your State Farm agent for a family insurance checkup. The advice is free.
And like a good neighbor.
And the decisions are yours.
State Farm is there.
The American League leads 3-0 in the All-Star game, and a new battery. It's Sid Fernandez, the winningest pitcher in the National League, 12-2, the Hawaiian-born left-hander, comes out of the bullpen to work the 8th, and his new battery mate is Jody Davis of the Chicago Cubs, who takes over for Gary Carter. as Kirby Puckett leads things off. Puckett has played the whole game, the starting center fielder, and Fernandez misses low for a ball, 1-0.
Well, it took 27 years since the state of Hawaii, 1959? And the pitcher now, Sid Fernandez and Charlie Huff, both from the state of Hawaii. And they're the first two pitchers ever to pitch from the state of Hawaii. Ron Darling was a member of the National League team last year. He's from Hawaii, but he did not pitch last year.
Huff left when he was young, and Fernandez, not only born there, grew up there and still lives there. Great star at Kaiser High School and a one-time Dodger. And when the Dodgers had their problems in the bullpen a couple of years back and had to go to the Mets to pick up the reliever Carlos Diaz, they had to part with Fernandez. And that has really turned out to backfire on L.A. 2-2.
And a very deceptive windup, very long, long stride. Hides the ball well. Good curveball. Basically a two-pitch pitcher. Come up with a little bit of a changeup. Leading the National League in wins with 12. See him miss with a curveball. Last year, I think the incredible thing, only 9-9, but had the lowest hits allowed per nine innings in the National League, even lower than Dwight Gooden. There's one criticism. He needs to throw more strikes. 57 walks in 118 innings this year, yet he still won 12 games.
Runs a lot of full counts as he does here, and Puckett draws the walk. And that is only the second walk in the game.
Take a look at Sid Fernandez. Again, very deceptive motion. Watch the long stride, uses his body very well. See the good follow through. You're going to teach somebody how to throw a pitch. That would be the way you want to do it. Just don't throw it with your arm. Use your body.
Now Lloyd Mosby bats for the first time of the game. The Blue Jays center fielder taking low, ball one. Puckett at first base and nobody out. Mike Kruko throwing in the National League bullpen. As Fernandez misses outside, so he's in arrears 2-0. National League trying to give Chubb Feeney another going away present. There's Kruko throwing. Chubb is the retiring president of the league, with Yale president A. Bartlett Giamatti taking over after the season. But the Americans have other ideas tonight. 3-0 in the eighth inning, and Fernandez behind now 3-0.
Lloyd Mosby hangs in there against lefties, and he's willing to take a walk. He's walked 41 times already this year. So if you're going to walk him, he'll take it, and he does.
So he went seven innings with one walk in the game. That was Schmidt, who was walked by Higuera in the fifth. And now Puckett walks on a 3-2 pitch, and Mosby walks on four pitches. And Hernandez goes to the mound to visit with Fernandez, a not uncommon sight during the regular season.
And so did Jody Davis. And in an all-star game, as a catcher, you really don't know what to tell the pitcher. You met him in the clubhouse. You usually faced him with a bat in your hand. You know, and you go out there, I mean, what are you going to tell him? Stay on top. I mean, there's nothing. You kind of just go out for show, give him the ball. And
throw strikes.
Throw strikes.
Well, in this case, that's
pretty
good advice.
He says okay and does it.
Meanwhile, here is Brooke Jacoby batting for Wade Boggs. The Cleveland third baseman comes up with runners at first and second, and he bunts foul. Now, normally in an all-star game, you're not going to see very much bunting with Puckett at second and Mosby at first. But in a situation like this, and the way things have gone for the American League, they're a little sensitive to the way they've been beat up on through the years, and they're looking for those extra runs here.
I suppose you're right, but you know, here's Jacoby's first at bat in the All-Star competition, and he's called upon to sacrifice.
Yep. He also had 20 home runs last year. This is not a normal situation for him. Acquired in 83 by the Indians for Len Barker. One of the trades that they've made over the last years that have really made them the surprise team in the American League. Record of 46-39, presently in third place, right behind the Yankees.
There you can see graphically the Americans dominate early on in the series. It started in 33. Then the Nationals win 11 of the 16, and then the real domination began as Jacoby goes down on strikes. So they sent him up there to bunt. Took one shot at that and then strikes out swinging. And as is the case oftentimes with Fernandez, you can get a lot of walks and a lot of strikeouts. You got two walks and one K.
Well, the deceptive high fastball, and I think the one thing that when you talk to hitters, what makes him, and Timmy, you've seen him all year, is that he throws the ball in so many different planes. A lot of balls up in the strike zone, but yet he can make the pitch down in the strike zone. So you really don't know where to look, up or down off Fernandez.
Yeah, he's one of those types of pitchers where you just throw the jug gun away, that radar gun. You don't even worry about it. He rarely breaks 90 miles an hour. The radar gun, important for pitchers like Clemens and Gooden, but not for a guy like Fernandez.
Jim Rice now of the Boston Red Sox, who's having a good year even though he's hitting fewer home runs. Hitting for a high average this season at .334. 9 homers. That's on Rice-like, but 60 RBIs.
Yes, but he can hit a home run. That's what is in the back of your mind. And the 60 RBIs this year means he's hitting with men on base.
Rice bats for Parrish with two on and one out in the eighth inning. 3-0 American League. 1-1.
It's almost like the gym has made a conscious effort to hit the ball the other way. One of the strongest hitters in baseball, and do that very well. Last year, 35 double plays. He's going the other way, staying out of the double play situation.
1-2. I would guess that's one of those Fernandez fastballs where if you haven't seen him, you probably can't believe how quickly it gets up there.
His foot hits the ground before his arm comes around. And usually when the foot hits the ground, the hitter has to commit himself, and then the arm comes from nowhere. And that was the type of swing, you're exactly right, that indicated the type of fastball that Fernandez throws most often.
1-2 pitch, the runners go. Rice strikes out. Davis's throw. Brown can't hang it out. It rolls away. The bucket has to hold. So Jim Rice strikes out, but Davis's throw was in the dirt, and the inning is still alive with Mattingly coming up.
Well, one of the problems a catcher has with a right-handed hitter up, he does have that impediment of the right-handed hitter, and Jody Davis threw the ball behind Rice and into the dirt. Chris Brown couldn't find the ball initially. Had Puckett come up and just taken off for home, I think he would have made it. Look at Brown. Brown doesn't know whether the ball's down there. He's trying to hold the glove down. He might have had a hold of Kirby's foot instead of the ball.
Mattingly, who has struck out and grounded out tonight. He didn't start the game. Wally Joyner did and went 0-for-1 as Mattingly takes outside.
Well, he's finding out what life in the All-Star game is all about. Twice against Fernando and again Fernandez. Not two easy pitchers to hit off of. Which, if you're a pitcher in the American League and you happen to be left-handed, you realize that Mr. Mattingly is not just an out. If you're left-handed, hangs in there very well. Last year, I think 17 or 18 of his 35 home runs were off left-handers.
One of those strange stats, New York Yankee hitters against Met pitchers were hitless before Dave Winfield got the double back in the third inning or the second inning. Now Don Mattingly trying to do the same thing, obviously unaware of that stat.
One ball, two strikes, a count on him.
Now, if this was Pete Rose at the plate, he would know that stat.
Oh, yeah, he'd know it. Yeah.
You know who the pitchers were and who the hitters were and what the exact 0-for-3, 0-for-4, whatever.
One, two pitch. 2-2 now. Runners in second and third with two down. There's Puckett. Mosby. First base open and Ripken on deck. And Mattingly goes down on strikes. So Fernandez strikes out the side. It's 3-0 American. Back after this from your local station.
Relive the fear, relive the terror of Steven Spielberg's Jaws Sunday. A Dallas Cowboy is missing from training camp. We will tell you who he is, and we will take a look at another veteran who's happy to be in camp right after the All-Star game.
They're always kidding me about how serious I make my sandwiches, but if I don't, who will? And these are very serious sandwiches. Seriously perfect roast beef for starters. Then the tomatoes, the lettuce. What could be more serious than them? The bread, that's what. Seriously fresh or forget about it. And I make them by hand every day so that when you walk into my 7-Eleven, you're gonna get a very serious sandwich.
Miller Lite presents Light Moments in Texas History. In 1682, while looking for the Mississippi, the French explorer La Salle wandered into Texas.
Hey, you guys seen a river around here? How about a brook?
He claimed the territory for France.
Well, you think it's funny, huh? Well, just for that, you're French.
But the settlement dispersed by 1689.
That goes for you, too. I lost $100 on your brother. Viva la Texas!
This Light Moment was brought to you by Miller Lite, the biggest beer in Texas.
Who publishes more books in a day than you could read in a lifetime? Puts through more calls to cars each week than the New York City Police Department? Who can transmit all the information in the encyclopedia in less than 2 seconds? And offers the most advanced products to handle it all? Who does all this? Southwestern Bell. From telephone to total communications.
This is 24, KVUE-TV, Austin.
Olympic gold medal ice dance greats Torval and Dean in a world premiere performance. Plus the Harlem Globetrotters on ABC's Wide World of Sports Saturday.
Scoring summary now, pretty brief. Dave Winfield, a two-out double in the second, and then Lou Whitaker hit a home run to make it 2-0. And Frank White hit a two-out 0-2 home run in the seventh inning, 3-0. The American League pitching has been brilliant, and Charlie Huff works on Chris Brown of the Giants in the bottom of the eighth inning. Chris Brown having a great season as the Giants have come to the fore, a team that finished dead last year, brought Roger Craig in to manage, and as the saying goes, you got to like these kids. Brown is one of the kids. Chili Davis is not a kid anymore. He's been around, but he's having a fine year. And Mike Kuko is the other Giant here in Houston. In the air to deep left field, and going back is Mosby to play it off the wall. And Brown, in his second year with the Giants in his first All-Star game, has a double.
We talked about waiting for the knuckleball, and watch Chris Brown wait for the knuckleball. Pops it over the head of Lloyd Mosby in left field, and that is the first extra base hit for the National League this evening. Of course, they only had two.
Well, he did what all great hitters do, committed himself but kept his hands back, had enough to go. And you talk to anybody and they say, what's the difference between Chris Brown 1985 and 1986? He's cut down on his strokes. Last year they saw him the finest fielder in the National League for third baseman. So one of the reasons why they're close to really leading the National League West.
On top by a game with Chili Davis. One of the few who wears his first name on the back of his uniform. Bite of blue of the Giants would be another as it's fouled away. The new catcher for the American League is Rich Gedman, and there he is. Gedman of the Red Sox batting in the four spot. And Brooke Jacoby has stayed in the game. The Indian third baseman bats third.
That's really not his name. That's just a word denoting the conditions at Candlestick.
You won't win a spelling bee with it, but you get the idea. Fouled away in the count 1-2. I mean, that kind of chili is supposed to be hot, isn't it?
Oh.
Right now, the National League has two hits. And wouldn't you know that Whitey Herzog's the manager? I mean, the Cardinals haven't hit all season, so what else is new for Whitey? He must feel right at home tonight. As Davis strikes out, but on a knuckleball, and Gedman throws to first and gets him on a great play. Brown goes to third. Rich Gedman hustling back, picking it up, and he had to think about the on-deck circle as well.
Throwing in one motion. Watch Gettman off with a mask. Davis didn't run right away, but Chili Davis can run. And Rich Gettman making a very quick play over there, obviously with first base unoccupied. Then on the third strike, the catcher must catch it. Gettman made some kind of play.
And UB Brooks, who comes up now, wasn't exactly giving him any help. Brooks was in the odd deck circle, and Gettman had to think about throwing around Brooks as well. Infield plays back. It's a strikeout and a wild pitch as Brooks takes a strike. Out here chanting, I believe we want Davis, Glenn Davis, the Astro, who was out earlier and would have pinch hit had a prior inning continued on.
20 home runs this year for the National League. As you look at Charlie Huff, and in all honesty, they are hitting the ball rather crisply. And Dick Houser with Dave Rigetti and Don Ostie leading the major leagues with 22 saves, and Willie Hernandez down the bullpen has chosen not to get anybody up.
I'll tell you, a lot of times you can tell apprehension in a catcher by what his right hand does. And watch Rich Gettman. Just before he receives the knuckleball, that hand goes out, it's rigid. And what he's trying to do is just to protect anything. He's got to call for the knuckleball. Now watch his right hand. See it open up like that? That's an apprehensive catcher. Believe me. Trust me, I guarantee you want to throw your body in front of the ball, anything you can, but the ball's dancing around. What do they call those butterfly catchers, or lepidopterist? Is that right?
You're asking us if that's right?
No, I think
who are you looking at?
It sounds
all right.
I'm looking at you.
Who do you think you're working with?
Another strikeout. It gets away from Gettman, who throws home, and Huff covers. No. Bruce Fleming says safe. And the perils of the knuckleball.
Yeah, but the play should have gone to first base. Watch his right hand come out. See how stiff it is? Remember we talked about waiting for the knuckleball to relax the arms. The arms weren't relaxed. And Gettman's plays at first base. If you get the out at first base, it's a 3-1 ball game, bottom of the eighth inning.
That's exactly what Charlie Huff is thinking as he's late covering home plate. Gettman makes the wrong play, so does Huff. And the run scores.
Remember the one hitter earlier in the year when Charlie Huff didn't cover home plate?
Exactly.
Beat him a ball game.
And a runner scored from second base. And that was the night that Huff came within a couple of outs of a no-hitter.
Right. Wally Joyner was the runner at second base. It ended up a one-hitter, and he lost 2-1 to California.
The only debatable thing, though, here is that you have three of the premier relievers in the American League that do not throw a knuckleball. You have a catcher that obviously is having difficulty. Why aren't any of them warming up?
Well, they heard you, because there goes Rigetti. As Raines, it's a bouncer foul. So Huff in the inning gives up the double. He has two strikeouts, but Gettman has to make a great play to get one out at first. That last strikeout is also a pass ball charge to Gettman to allow the run to score. It's 3-1 with Brooks at first base. One out, and Raines up for the second time in the game. Charlie Huff, 38 years old, a long career, finally makes it to an All-Star game, and as Jim mentioned, started the season on the disabled list with that weird handshake. He was actually shaking hands with a circuit court judge in Florida, good buddy of his, and they went through a pinky shake, and the shake sent Huff to the bench, and the judge went back to the bench as well. Chopper foul, and it's still 0-2.
Obviously, it's a terrible situation for Rich Gettman. I mean, here's his first experience, to my knowledge, at handling a knuckleball. Jim, you said earlier that Lance Parrish had handled one in AAA ball. I know that Gettman hasn't been handling a knuckleballer at Fenway this year.
It also presents another problem. A knuckleballer ball doesn't get there quick. You're talking about somebody that throws 60 miles per hour.
Time had been called by Bruce Fleming, the plate umpire, because a balk had been called. So Huff has thrown a wild pitch. His knuckler leads to a pass ball, and now a balk.
I think he called it on the stop. You got to come to a 1,001 second stop, but no knuckleballer that I've ever seen ever stops.
Well, no pitcher ever does if he can get away with it.
That's right.
And the reason he's not stopping is because the reason he doesn't stop is because it takes longer. He doesn't get the ball to home plate as quickly, and you can steal easier off knuckleballers. Gettman knows that. Huff knows that. So does the National League.
1-2. Don Ossie of the Orioles joins Dave Righetti in the American League pen. 3-1, the American League. One out. Brooks at second. And Raines fouls it away. Still 1-2. Virginia Raines. Tim's wife and her husband representing the tying run.
Tell you, Virginia Raines, quite an athlete in her own right, down in Sanford, Florida. Ran track down there. Marvelous athlete.
2-2. Their kids might have a little sprinter's breeding, huh?
They got a shot. Gettman doing a good job just trying to battle that knuckleball back there. Certainly empathize with it.
3-2.
I don't think Charlie Huff doesn't know that. You can't give a pitcher a lot of confidence if he knows the catcher can't catch what he's throwing. So maybe you just don't throw as good a knuckleball, and then you give a little bit of an advantage to the hitter. This guy doesn't need an advantage.
Got him. Throw him the knuckleball, and Gettman makes the tag for the out. So Huff has now struck out three in the inning, but there's still one out to get. As Steve Sachs of the Dodgers comes up.
Here's that bug one more time. The dead spin. Dead spin. Look, reaching right, coming back left, and it finally hits the heel of the glove. I'll tell you, sometimes you're not a catcher when you're catching a knuckleballer. You're a blocker. Get a lot of skate saves back there.
Sachs is at the plate. A 5-1. So Huff has a chance to strike out four in the inning.
Take a wild shot and say that that's never been done.
I would think so. Not in the All-Star game. It's been done in regular season baseball. 2-0 the count. Has not been done in All-Star competition. Meanwhile, we've had 19 strikeouts in the game tonight as the pitchers have fastballed for a strike and the count is 2-1. Brooks is at second. Two out. 2-1 on Steve Sachs. 2-2.
Huff throws a good knuckleball, the hitter can't hit it, and the catcher can't catch it.
For the same reason.
Did you ever have a problem similar to this?
Oh, you can, of course.
To left center for a base hit. And a run will score as the throw comes to second. So it's 3-2, and the crowd will really explode now because Glenn Davis of the Astros comes up to pinch hit.
Well, a good knuckleball, but it's down the middle of the plate. And McCarver says Sachs waits on it, and Mosby concedes the run. Something they should have done earlier in the inning.
Right.
Taking the out at first base.
You're right. That way the inning's over.
Meanwhile, Hauser comes out to the mound. He's got Ossie in the bullpen and Dave Righetti. This is something a manager really doesn't want to do in an All-Star game, go to the mound and get somebody, but he's got to do it here with Glenn Davis coming up 3-2 American League. We'll be back.
For all those performance cars that want to keep performing even in wet, sloppy weather, Goodyear introduces the Eagle GT Plus 4. High performance and all-weather performance in one remarkable tire. The Eagle GT Plus 4. The performance won't be canceled by the weather. You either have Goodyear Eagles or you need them.
Me too. Try me, honey. Try me.
At Harris 3M, you get more than great copies. You get Harris 3M people, so your job runs smoothly. Why try anyone else?
Try me.
You really want to appreciate the Coors difference. Less heavy, easy drinking. Try spending some time doing this. Oh, yeah. Coors is the one.
Rip Sewell pitched in 3 All-Star games in the 40s, but is best known for serving up this home run to Ted Williams on his famous Eefus pitch. Today, despite the loss of both legs, Rip manages 3 rounds of golf a week in the Florida sunshine. Dave Righetti of the New York Yankees comes out of the bullpen now to face Glenn Davis, who leads the National League in home runs. And that's remarkable because in this ballpark, it's very difficult to hit homers. It's almost impossible for an Astro or a Cardinal, let's say, at Busch Stadium to lead the league in homers, but Davis has a good shot.
To give you some idea, he has hit 9 home runs in this ballpark, and 2 years ago, the entire Astro team hit 18 all year.
Incredible strength, a quick bat, likes the ball out over the plate. You're going to try to get him out. You want to come up and in. Righetti certainly has the velocity to do that. I think the reason Dick Houser brought him in is Steve Sachs with 22 stolen bases. You bring in Righetti, a little tougher to steal on. Don Ossie, who's leading the major leagues in saves, is right-handed. Tall guy, about 6'4", 6'5", easier to steal on. What Righetti has fallen prey to this year is the lack of a setup man in New York. Brian Fisher, the man they counted on, has not done the job. Has been, he's still with the Yankees, but sent out a time or two.
There goes Sachs. Good jump up and in. The throw to second is not in time.
So they steal the base anyway. And as in many times, you go on the first move from a left-hander. Steve with a good jump. Gedman with a quick release makes a good throw, but it's not in time. Sachs easily beats the throw. Frank White with a nice stop, keeping the ball from going into center field.
1-0 on Glenn Davis, the Astro first baseman. Fouled away. 1-1. Well, this is storybook time. The local hero makes good. He's the go-ahead run.
As George Brett said so many times, we give them a little opportunity talking about the American League, and they usually seize it. Gedman didn't take the out at first base. He had the leading home run hitter at the plate.
And it's 2-1. Jacoby of the Indians makes the catch, and that's that. But the Nationals get 2 to make it 3-2 as we go to the ninth.
styling originated in Europe, where they value design. It is built in Japan, where they value efficiency. And it is sold at your Chevrolet dealer, where they still value value. Now get 5.9 annual percentage rate GMAC financing. Length of finance contract is limited. New Spectrum from today's Chevrolet.
Introducing Kodacolor BRG, film that captures the color of power. Accurate, realistic color and print film is here. New Kodacolor BRG.
The color of light.
Who's gonna be at the Silver Bullet tonight?
The Silver Bullet? Oh, I think it's romantic.
Romantic?
Yeah, Rob, look around. People come in, have a Coors Light, have a few laughs. They could be with 30 people or alone with someone. The Silver Bullet's a very romantic place.
Your eyes.
What?
The way you said that, there's just... something about your eyes.
Rob, it's not that romantic.
There's no slowing down with a Silver Bullet.
You're right.
Coors Light Beer.
Regular breast x-rays for women over 40 could save thousands of lives. We'll have a report on why most doctors are not giving them tomorrow on World News Tonight.
There are the attractions this week on ABC's Wide World of Sports Saturday. Torval and Dean, the sensational Olympic ice dancing gold medalist in action in the World Ice Spectacular, and the Harlem Globetrotters on ABC's Wide World of Sports. Then July 26th, the heavyweight fight, Mike Tyson against Marvis Frazier, and a look back at the recent fight between Barry McGuigan and Steve Cruz, with Cruz upsetting the Irishman. Mike Kruko of the San Francisco Giants, thrilled to be in an all-star game, having a great season for the Giants, and pitching the ninth inning here, going to work on Ripken in the count 1-0. So Cal Ripken, who's played every inning for 4 years, just keeps on rolling. It's the ninth and he's still in there.
What's the old saying? You rest in the wintertime, right?
Closest that streak ever came to ending was last year, where he sprained his ankle like on a Monday night, iced it all night long, all day long, and then taped it up and went out and played.
Barfield and White to follow. Nice stop by Kruko. Stabs it on a hop. Takes care of Ripken, who goes 0 for 4 tonight without hitting the ball out of the infield. 12 strikeouts for the American League tonight, and the National Leaguers have struck out 7 times, so a record has been tied, and we're on the verge of a new one. 19 strikeouts total in the game. The All-Star game marks that 2 years ago a Candlestick with 21. Barfield at the plate, 1-0. When the National League bats in the bottom of the ninth inning, it'll be Keith Hernandez. Then they go to the pitcher's spot. They'll hit for Kruko, and then Dave Parker is due up third. Popped up. Brown is there. And Chris puts it away. Two gone. And Frank White, who is now the difference in the game. White came up in the seventh inning, two out. The count went to 0-2. The crowd began to rise to its feet in anticipation of the Astro Mike Scott striking the side out. And then White parked one into the seats and left.
Very big run. What that run did was really make a grand slam, or four runs, the amount of runs that the National League needed to come up with to beat the American League. And it's just a classic game of baseball, whether it's the World Series, the All-Star game, a regular Major League season. The National League has really made two mistakes. 0-2 curveball by Gooden, the 0-2 pitch by Scott. Both have turned out to be home runs.
Fly ball to left field. Tim Raines will put it away. And up come the National League in the bottom of the ninth inning with the Americans on top, 3-2.
Quiet nights by firelight and Mars roasting almonds. These are some of the best things in life. Barefooting in ponds, splashing with swans and Mars buttery caramel. Losing your knots in all the right spots and Mars rich chocolate. These are some of the best things in life.
It's the little rewards that make life great. Mars Bar, one great little reward.
Some of the best things in life.
Hey, me fellas. Look here. Seagulls, 41 cooler. Seagulls, golden wine cooler. It's wet and it's dry.
Nuggets, they're new and here this year. So bring your good friends and your family too. Wendy's got crispy chicken nuggets for you. Come on now.
Crispy nuggets.
Let's all celebrate and have a good time.
Come celebrate new crispy chicken nuggets at Wendy's.
Dave Righetti tries to save it for the American League. Again, the American League has not won an All-Star game in a National League park since 1962. Wrigley Field in Chicago. That's the last time. The Americans since then have won in Detroit in 71 and in Comiskey in Chicago in 83. And that's Willie Hernandez and Don Ossie throwing in the bullpen. With Keith Hernandez coming up, then Jody Davis will bat second in the inning, as they had inserted Davis into the four spot when he came in, and Parker hits third. Monday Night Baseball back next week. The Mets against Cincinnati. The Giants taking on the Cardinals. Check your local listings for the game in your area. So on the Astrodome, where it's been a big year for the Houston Astros, new manager Hal Lanier, new president and general manager Dick Wagner, and a capacity crowd at the Dome looking on, hopeful of a National League comeback here as Hernandez starts the bottom of the ninth inning with a chopper back of third, fielded in fair ground by Jacoby, guns him down. So Keith is 0 for 4 tonight. And Jody Davis.
Jacoby on the line at third plate, on at third base. In the All-Star game, you play standard brand baseball, and traditionally, whenever in doubt, you go to what you've been doing for years, and that's guarding the line. And that time it paid off.
Well, we talked about that in the playoffs. It might not always be the right thing to do, but certainly paid off then.
Davis takes outside. One change for the American League. They finally get Cal Ripken out of a ballgame. That's the significance of this. Tony Fernandez, the brilliant young shortstop of the Blue Jays, taking over. Davis rips it into center field for a base hit. And so the tying run is at first base. And Dave Parker comes up as the winning run.
Well, most likely you'll see a pinch runner here. Tony Pena, the third catcher. Take a look at the fastball. Right down the middle. Davis having an excellent year, just pings it to center field. So you have the tying run at first and the winning run at the plate.
And I love it. Tony Pena is a pinch runner. Those catchers can do it all, pal.
Some catchers.
Well, let's see, you 67 All-Star game, you're 3 for 3. You led the National League in triples. What else can we get to tonight? Well, I still can't believe that.
Dave Parker, who, if he hit a home run, would cement the MVP award of this game, I'm sure, and that's something he's already won back in 79 with his arm. Fouled it away. He threw out two runners that night at the Kingdome in Seattle, July 17, 1979, to win the MVP award. And he was 1 for 3 at the plate in that one. Tonight, Parker 0 for 1, having grounded out. Rips it, base hit into right field. Pena around second, goes to third, and so the tying and winning runs are on. And with Rigetti a left-hander and Chris Brown a right-handed batter coming up, Hauser goes to the mound. He has Don Ossie in the bullpen for Baltimore and Hernandez.
Watch this reaction by Dave Parker, extending those arms and rifling one to right field. Check this out. You like that?
Very much. They don't want to win too badly, do they?
Well, I can smell it now. Hauser says, give me the right-hander, not Hernandez, who started it. He wants Ossie to face Brown. And we'll be back after this.
This is where it begins. Anywhere there's moisture, there's the chance of catching athlete's foot. This is where it ends. Mycotin. Only Mycotin cures athlete's foot with miconazole, a medically proven ingredient that eliminates athlete's foot. This is where athlete's foot begins. This is where it ends. Mycotin. The end of athlete's foot.
The essence of bobsledding.
The new sled feels like gliding on silk.
The essence of shaving.
This is Aftra Plus, an incredible advance in Gillette's shaving smoothness. The Plus is the white Lubra smooth strip that releases lubricants as you shave. You never felt anything smoother.
Aftra Plus by Gillette, the essence of shaving.
In the Army, we do more before 9 a.m. than most people do all day.
Hey, First Sergeant. Good morning.
Hey, where did you learn about computers?
In the Army.
You were in the Army, too?
Qualify for the GI Bill and the Army College Fund, hey, and you can earn over $25,000 for college.
What did you do in the Army?
Airborne.
You used to jump out of airplanes?
Don Ossie having a great year with the Orioles, and so it comes down to Ossie trying to slay the Giants. He's got Chris Brown and then Chili Davis on deck. Meanwhile, there was Willie Hernandez thinking he was coming into the game. The left-hander with a screwball thought he was coming in to face the righty, and Ossie says, excuse me.
Yes, let 23 saves pass him by. Looking at a total of 41 saves down there, those two guys. One of the reasons, as you look at Chris Brown, doubled his first time up. Ossie is the reason the Orioles have stayed within 10 games of the Red Sox in the American League East.
The infield is a double play depth, and it's 1-0. So it'll be interesting on a ground ball. If they can turn it, the game would be over. If they get the force, the game would be tied.
He can be a strikeout pitcher.
And there's a little grounder to second, and White touches for one and throws to first for a double play. And so they play the infield halfway, and it works. With White throwing out Brown in the American League, and Dick Hauser comes to Houston and wins an All-Star game in a National League park for the first time in 24 years. Good ballgame.
Certainly was a check swing by Chris Brown. And he hit the ball too hard towards second. Dick Hauser gambling, and the double play worked. Easy double play for Frank White. Here it is one more time. Watch the check swing.
Well, the reason for this, Timmy, is that a slider looks like a fastball. Brown thinks it's a fastball. Halfway commits himself. One of the best second basemen in baseball.
The MVP is Roger Clemens, and there were several candidates tonight. The Chevrolet Most Valuable Player for the 1986 All-Star Game. The Boston right-hander who grew up here in Houston and pitched three perfect innings. Valenzuela was brilliant tonight. Lou Whitaker hit a two-run homer. You can make a case for him. Frank White hit a home run in the seventh inning that turned out to be the game winner. Don Ossie comes out of the bullpen to induce the double play with a tying and winning runs on base. So that's the story. Al Michaels, Jim Palmer, Tim McCarver, Don Drysdale, with thanks to Alan Roth and Steve Hurd, saying goodnight from Houston, where the All-Star Game has been brought to you by Coors and Coors Light. Beers with a difference worth tasting. by Chevrolet, who invites you to drive today's Chevy, live today's Chevy. By Goodyear, you either have Goodyear Eagles or you need them. And by United States Liberty Coins. Keep Liberty in mint condition with United States Liberty Coins. Again, the final score was the American League 3, the National League 2. Be sure to join us tonight for ABC News Nightline immediately following your late local news. Travel arrangements made through a promotional fee paid by United Airlines. United flies more people to Hawaii than any other airline. Nobody knows Hawaii like United. This has been a presentation of ABC Sports, recognized around the world as the leader in sports television.